Jim Henson Studios, which is
the best.
A huge part of my history. Mm-hmm. I mean, I was from 67 to 74, I was a songwriter here, writing for mainly, you know, the Carpenters and all the work I did through the years with the Muppets. And then I came back for what was a really remarkable, remarkable experience, which was for Random Access Memories and Daft Punk. Almost everything that I worked on, There's been a Caswell touch there musically and all, and it's interesting because a lot of stuff that I write alone, words and music, I'm a horrible musician. I'll sit with Cas and I go, you know, I don't know what this chord is, but it's, God, it's different and it's unusual, beautiful. I can't find it. And Cas will go, and hit it. And I go, wow, what is that? And he'll go, a D.
Before he was sober?
Yes.
Oh, he's the only person that ever said, I'm worried about you. The drugs and the alcohol are getting out of hand. And I fired him.
Yes.
I did. Right. I rewarded that caring, you know, like the courage to say something.
So tell me, how did you guys get involved with Daft Punk initially?
Well, I had done arrangements for Tron and then was asked by the guys to come in. We started talking and everything, and that led to Paul Williams. And, oh, could we meet him? We would love to meet him. And so I called Paul and arranged for them to go down to his place where they met. From what I understood from them, the whole helmet thing, you got Phantom of the Paradise, which there they were in helmets. And so they wanted to meet Paul right away.
I found out that they met at the theater where Phantom of the Paradise was playing in Paris, and they supposedly saw it together 20 times. I got excited about the music. I got excited about the whole project and all. And the journey began. I think one of the things that was so exciting about Random Access Memories is they never really said, this is what it's about.
No, there wasn't a theme to it, but when they got me together the first time and we started talking, it was all about experimentation.
Nothing is
no, but you know what it is? It's human feeling, almost like it was quantized, but human still. It's so cool.
Well, the first thing they said was, we want to record this both analog and digital. We want real musicians. So I said, well, I know lots of musicians. And they said, well, just pick some and give them to us. So, you know, James Genus and Omar Hakim, they came from New York, and from here, Nathan East and Paul Jackson. And so when it all came together, they were amazing.
The first thing they gave me to consider writing words for was the music to Touch. And it's just so, it crawls inside you. Down, da 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 da. It's classically beautiful, I think.
Kiss, suddenly alive, happiness.
I don't think that songs begin with a blank page. I think songs begin in your past with, you know, somebody did something that broke you. And somebody did something to put you back together. And you come to a moment where somebody plays you some music and it ignites that past, that part of your past. And what's amazing is when somebody else feels the same thing. One of the guys said something basically about, it would be great to do a big kind of orchestral thing at the end that has a basic message. What is the message? And Kaz writes this music, and I'm going, hold on, if love is the answer, we're home. Hold on. It's like, right. In that moment. And then he orchestrates it, and it will make you cry. you write it down and get credit for it, but I heard it in his music.
There were many times during the whole process of everything where I'd just be playing or something and one of them would go, no, what's that? Do that again. And I still have a hard drive that has recordings of when Geeman would sing something to me. And it's just like him going like, he would like do this, and I still have the recordings.
One of the things I remember was when almost immediately when they heard it, they said, a children's choir.
Yes,
we need to put a children's choir on here.
Choir, yes.
There's no children's choir on this album.
Actually, a friend of mine, Angie, who does a lot of singing and everything, said, yeah, I can get the choir together. And it was pretty crazy.
When they did Epilogue, when they used that music, you know, it's a little heavy-hearted and yet it's so inspiring.
I know that they're both going their own way, which is a great thing, but it was sad to hear it.
My parting words to the robots would be, thank you for the sparkly gift you gave me. Gave me an opportunity to, at an age when most guys are sitting on their porch yelling, get off my lawn. You gave me an opportunity to participate in something that was life-changing for some people and life-changing for me, because it made me passionate about music in a way that was always there, but, you know, you turned up the heat. You know, I'm forever grateful, guys. Thank you. It's a really remarkable, remarkable album. For some people, I think it was a door to something beyond. It's like they had all these balls in the air, and each of those balls was a piece of art and an approach to life and all this stuff that they magnetically put back together and said, explore, explore. There's so much out there. Go get something fattening to eat.